Hello, welcome to a Nihon Donobi, Beauty of Japanese Sword. My name is Hisashi Saito, owner of Seikodo in Ginza, Tokyo. In this first video, we will look at the denrai provenance can add to our appreciation of sword.
Japanese swords have always played an integral role in the history and culture of Japan. And because swords were prized by owners for centuries, the concept of denrai, or provenance, can really add depth to appreciation for modern collectors. And the more detailed the historical records, the more fascinating it can be to think about what the sword has witnessed before our time. To illustrate, we have an interesting Juyotoken piece by Izumi no Kami Kanesada, whose owners included powerful historical figures toward the end of the Edo period.
This is an excellent example of Mino work from the Muromachi period.
Obviously, only the best swords will boast provenance tied to lords or prominent families. Let's start by taking a look at the sword. The second generation Kanesada, also known as Nosada for the way he carved his signature, was one of the best smiths of the late Mino tradition, active around the turn of the 16th century. This sword features a slightly pronounced itame wood grain, and a very interesting hamon which widens from the monouchi area toward the point and mixes notare, gunome, choji, and much activity. One outstanding feature of this sword is its size. Katana in the late Muromachi period generally had a hawatari length around 60 centimeters. This sword has a grand sugata at 77 centimeters and was possibly made by special order.
Swords of Kanesada school were well known for their extreme sharpness.
Indeed, swords by Izumi no Kami Kanesada were ranked as owazamono, or excellent, for their ability to cut. Tameshigiri cutting tests were sometimes performed on swords, with the results, also called setsudanme, inscribed into the tang. In the early Edo period, the Yamano family were recognized as official sword testers by the shogunate. These tests were performed on the corpses of convicted criminals, and various types of cuts were made with differing levels of difficulty. In the early 19th century, Yamada Asaimo, who was also a sword tester, published a rating of the sharpness of swords based on cutting tests. These rankings included Saijo Owazamono, which were the best, Owazamono, which were excellent, Ryowazamono, which were very good, and wazamono, which were good. Naturally, only a small fraction of swords were tested, and many koto master swordsmiths were not included, but it's still an interesting view into the history of sword ratings and appreciation.
It's not a surprise that this sword was owned by a famous family throughout history.
Historical records for this sword are very detailed. Records kept by the Tokugawa shogunate note that this sword was bestowed by the 14th Tokugawa shogun, Iemochi, to the 29th head of the Shimazu family, Tadayoshi, upon his visit to announce his succession as a family head. The koshirai, which was bestowed together with the blade, reflects fittings appropriate for a presentation sword. The presentation of swords between lords, shoguns, and the imperial family had long existed in Japanese history. There are actually documents from the Muromachi period which define appropriate swordsmiths for presentation swords to the shogunate. These lists are an interesting view into what were considered the rarest and most valuable swordsmiths of the time, and include, for example, several Awataguchi smiths as Hisakuni, Kunitsuna, Toshiro Yoshimitsu, from Soshu, Masamune, Sadamune, and several Kobizen smiths as Masatsune and Tomonari. Presentation swords were predominantly koto until the Edo period, when it said the 8th Tokugawa shogun, Yoshimune, as a part of his efforts to encourage the works of modern swordsmiths of the time, likely introduced the custom of shinto as presentation swords.
The Shimazu family was very important in shaping Japanese history.
Shimazu Tadayoshi was the 12th and final lord of Satsuma, one of the largest Tozama daimyo centered in current-day Kagoshima Prefecture. The Tozama, or outside daimyo, were large, wealthy, and had a unique distance relationship from the central Tokugawa shogunate. Satsuma in particular would play a major role ending Tokugawa rule and restoring the imperial government in the Meiji period. Additional historical records kept by the Shimazu family make specific reference to the sword, down to the point when it was ultimately sold by the family heirs in 1928. From that standpoint, it's so interesting to think about what Japanese swords, particularly masterpieces like this, have seen in the hands of individuals who shaped history.
Thank you for watching this fourth episode of Nihon Tanobi Beauty of Japanese Sword. I hope people will be curious about the deep history surrounding Japanese sword.